you all for coming today to the first of our spring lecture series. The series theme this year is Surviving and Thriving in Adolescence. Our theme of the spring lecture series is building off of our fall forum, where we had Robert Crosno talking about healthy connections, shaping relationships, and achievement in high school. We thought it would be really interesting to expand on some of those ideas and build on different kinds of research on adolescence for our spring lecture series. So we have four talks this semester, and you've received a handout up front about those talks. I'll talk about the first one in a few minutes. On February 14th, we'll have Sam Ehrenreich. I never say his name right. I'm sorry, Sam. How do you say your last name?
Ehrenreich.
Thank you. On adolescent text messaging and the development of antisocial behavior. On March 7th, we have Alex Picaro talking about preventing juveniles from a life of crime. And then on April 25th, we have Joanna Ginch talking about beyond the birds and the bees. Communication about sexuality from childhood to adolescence. So it should be a really fun series. One thing that you should have received in your handouts at the beginning was a feedback form. And we encourage you to fill out those feedback forms at the end of the talk. You can hand them in either up front or you can hand them in on the table on your way out. It's very helpful for us to have your feedback. It helps us in building the series in the future, helps us know what kinds of things interest you, more about your backgrounds. So that would be very useful for us. Now I'd like to turn a little bit to introducing today's speaker, Dr. Emily Tobey. Dr. Emily Tobey received her Bachelor's of Arts in Speech Pathology and Audiology from New Mexico State University, her Master's of Communication Disorders degree in Speech Pathology from Louisiana State University, and her doctorate degree in Speech Science from the City University of New York. She currently serves as Professor and Nell C. Johnston Chair in Communication Disorders, as well as Vice Provost for Faculty Development here at UT Dallas. My understanding from others in the field is that Emily is the leading scholar looking at pediatric cochlear implants. She has been so for over 20 years. One of the really interesting things about her background is that Emily was part of the team, as I understand it, that organized the first FDA clinical trials of cochlear implants. And she was one of the first investigators to conduct studies of individuals receiving those devices to understand more about their outcomes, not only in terms of speech and hearing or receiving sounds and things like that, but also looking at other kinds of long-term outcomes for quality of life. She's received extensive grant support from the National Institutes of Health, the National Science Foundation, the Food and Drug Administration, and other funding organizations to support her work. On a more personal note, Emily is a lovely person to be around. I remember a few years ago, there was a session for women faculty members over at her house, and it was just very clear from that meeting, it was the first time we really got to chat in more detail, how much she wants people to succeed. Regardless of their background, regardless of whether they're talking about their occupation, being a professor here, being in different areas of the field, she just seems like she's really interested in helping people to succeed. And I've heard some of the things from her former students, and graduate students, her postdoctoral students. Many of her students have gone off to be successful scholars themselves. They've noted that she's extremely generous with her time and her resources, which is something we all probably take advantage of more than we should. But we thank her very much for that sort of thing. I'm very excited that Emily is going to be with us today. One thing she asked me about first was to get a sense of who's here, what your background is. So if you could raise your hand if you are professional working on something related to hearing, cochlear implants, things like that, raise your hand. Okay, raise your hand if you are a student. Raise your hand if you are a parent of someone perhaps with a hearing impairment or anything like that. Anybody who has a hearing impairment in here? A few. One thing we have as a resource available to you, and I apologize because I know I'm a fast talker, is on this side of the room, there's a screen that will have the details of what we're speaking about. And so if you need to use that as a resource, you can please feel free to move over to that side of the room or take a look at that screen to help you out. And now I'd like to go ahead and welcome Dr. Emily Tobey. Thank you.
Thank you, darling. Good to see you. Hello, and welcome. I'm pleased to be here, and I also want to make it very clear, particularly to the parents and to people who are impaired, if there is a question that you wish to ask, raise. Just raise your hand. I'm happy to be interrupted and to be clarified at any time. for the students? Not so much. just a little joke, But but please feel free, because what I'm going to do today is try to talk about research. Oops, I'm still on mute. Am I still on mute?
That's better.
Is this better?
Yeah, I think so.
Can it, in the back, can you hear me? Yes? Okay. So what I want to do today is to walk us through a couple of things. But before I kind of get there, I have to figure out this device. I want to acknowledge, I do not do anything by myself. I have to like just start off saying. And I have a number of students who work with me. Would you all please stand? Those of you who are, no, it's okay. The ones that are here, I have like tons more out other places, but I kind of want students to like know who's going. I also, in my commercial acknowledgement, have to acknowledge that all the work I'm going to be talking about today has been funded by the National Institute of Health, the Dana Foundation, and the National Science Foundation. And this is important because as we talk about sequestering, I think it puts a certain sense of how important the work is that we're doing relative to what's going on in the United States. So we are talking about the fact that we've had continuous funding in my laboratory since 1975. And so the work I'll be talking about today is work that is critical for our nation. It's critical for you as professionals, and it's critical for parents. I'm going to make my talk in sort of big pieces. I'm going to talk about what the long-term outcomes are using implants. I'm going to spend a little bit about talking about technology, because technology is where the future is. I'm going to talk about communication performance. And then I'm going to sort of talk about how executive functioning and how, as we're looking at the very first cohort, we're just now looking at the very first set of children who received cochlear implants after FDA approval are moving into the teenage years, and what our challenges are as professionals and what I believe are going to be our future challenges. So let's start with the big picture. The big picture is we are now estimating that there are 30 million Americans who have a hearing loss. And I really like this sort of cartoon, particularly for those of you who are students who can talk about it, because in 1880, everything was analog and it was all very visual. You could see all the information you needed. Okay? You could go to the cash register, numbers were there, it was all very visible. But if we go to 1980, and if I was to put another picture onto here, to where we are now, information is not that visible. In point of fact, as soon as we went digital, for a person who had a hearing impairment, which is going to affect all of us. I mean, I can talk about somebody who's deaf, but every person in this room will have a hearing loss at some point in your life. Every person. I mean, all you have to do is think about your grandparents. And for those of you who are young, and I know there are a lot of students, every one of you who is using an MP3, talking on your cell phone in the car, and being in a noisy environment are damaging hair cells, which ultimately means you'll have a significant hearing loss when you're older that is worse than what we're talking about now. But the problem becomes is the state of Texas was a very advanced place. We were one of the first states in the world to recognize that the identification of hearing impaired people was very, very important. And so we introduced newborn hearing screening, which is now captured across the world, not only in our United States, but is going across the world, so that a baby born in Texas has a hearing screening on the time period that the mom is in the hospital. They are identified then. We went from when I was in 1995 identifying children at 4.5 years of age to identifying babies within 4 months of age. This means that we can actually introduce young babies to hearing during the critical time period where their brain is sprouting and pruning, making connections, and you have the largest language jump that you have in your entire life. You go from nothing to almost 5,000 words. It's incredible. But this is the problem. This is a huge problem. We can identify babies. We can put hearing aids on them. We can put other technology on them. But we introduce them to our current educational school system. If I take a baby and I introduce that baby to a deaf education, Gallaudet University has stable statistics to indicate that child, if they go through that system, all the way through high school, will read at a third grade level. Now, let me give you the impact of that, because if you want to read the Dallas Morning News, you need to read at a sixth grade level. If you want to use the internet, you need to read at a 12th grade reading level. The significance of having no literacy or limited literacy is overwhelming in the United States. $48.7 billion go to SSI kinds of benefits that we have to expend on people who do not read and who do not know how to move through our world. Now, in the old days, and I always like to start with this part because it's very important. In the old days, we used to think that hearing impaired and deaf people were deaf and dumb. And we assumed if they graduated with only a third grade reading level, they were dumb. But then we moved a little bit in the early 1900s and we said, no, they're not deaf and dumb. They're just simply deaf and mute. And I show you here a picture from Gallaudet University, for those of you who are students. This is a speech pathologist showing how, in the old days, we used to try to evoke a gag reflex to indicate to a child, how do you make the difference between B and M? Because a soft palate has to go up and down. But, of course, you and I know that this is not true, because like in the 80s, we had a huge upsurging at Gallaudet University, the National University for the Deaf in the United States. They protested that they had a culture, and that their culture was related to their language, and that they were not deaf and dumb. They were culturally different. And of course, we can see that. I show you here Girl in Green by John Brewster. He was deaf. It's a beautiful, beautiful photo. This is one of my favorites. I show you the Chesapeake Bay Retriever with Goose by Fresenio. A man who was deaf. And look how he captured the eyes of that dog. I show you Lamonto, in a beautiful attempt to try to show the motion over time that goes with being deaf. The moment when Helen Keller who was blind and deaf, put her hand under a water faucet, and there was a therapist, Ann Sullivan, who signed water, and she caught the two concepts. But what a portrayal of how harsh and how lonely it must be. And yet how powerful. So here I show you The Mechanics by Douglas Tilden. Look how powerful this is. Again, by a deaf artist. Now, I don't have to go much further. I'm sure everyone in this audience recognizes this picture. Abraham Lincoln Memorial. Well, it turns out that the sculptor of this particular monument was a close friend with Thomas Gallaudet, who formed the Gallaudet University. And what David French wanted to have was a piece of sculpture that represented the division that occurred during the Civil War and a melding of how wonderful the world was when the war was over. And so what he did was he went to sign language and he said, what I need is I need the fist to go forward, an A, in sign language, to recognize that there was a division in our country. And I need something welcoming to say, come back. So he picked an L. So when you go the next time to this Lincoln Memorial, see the A, see the L, and recognize that the country is melded for diversity between hearing and non-hearing individuals. It also turns out that it is a melding for our political situations as well. So I'm going to simply ask, is deafness a problem? And I'm assuming most of you who are here recognize it is. If I look at the ear on the outside, in humans, we use it for decoration, solely, purely for decoration. If I'm a cat or a dog, I move my ears to localize. But we don't do that as humans. We use it as decoration. So that sound is going to come in through the auditory meatus. It's going to hit up against the tympanic membrane, the eardrum. It's going to move little ossicles, which you see in the middle ear. And that is then going to go to the cochlea, which is literally about the size of the tip of your little finger. It's a snail-like organ that's fluid-filled. It has little cilia or hair cells that vibrate. But it's magical. It is the most organized organ you have in your body. So I can actually stretch out the cochlea and find that different spaces in the cochlea are going to respond to different frequencies. More importantly, those different frequencies and the spaces are connected to neurons who take that information all the way up to the cortex, either ipsilaterally on one side or contralaterally. And so I have this robust, highly organized system that I can, like, control. Now, it makes it easy because what happens in a sensory neural hearing loss, which all of you are going to have, I'm going to keep repeating that, use good wisdom in listening, you're going to lose the hair cells, those little cilia, that are going to connect to this neuron. And the neurons are going to go up all the way to the auditory brainstem, through there to the auditory cortex. It's a highly organized system. And I will argue with you that it is the reason why we can have a cochlear implant that works and restores hearing and helps children hear, and people have not been able to do a similar system in the visual system. or the tactile system. So let's now look at what goes on. Because really, I can talk about deafness. I mean, I can talk about hearing losses all I want to for you all. But that's not the key thing. I mean, I don't need to know always that I cross the street or the alarm is going off or whatever. What I need to know is how do I communicate with each of you? And how do you communicate with me? How do I attack that literacy problem in a way that's intelligent? So it's worth going back in time. I particularly love this quote that says, "Oh, you men who say that I'm malevolent, stubborn, or misanthropic, how greatly you wrong me. You do not know the secret cause which calls me to feel that way to you, because for 6 years now, I've been hopelessly afflicted. I've been made worse by senseless physicians. From year to year, I've been deceived with hopes of improvement. I have been finally compelled to face the prospects of a lasting malady whose cure will take years or possibly be impossible. My misfortune is doubly painful to me because I am bound to be misunderstood. For there can be no relaxation for my fellow man, no refined conversation, no mutual exchange of ideas. I must live alone, like one who has been banished. I am compelled to withdraw myself to live life alone. If at times I try to forget this, oh, how harshly I am flung back by my experience of my bad hearing. Yet it is impossible for me to say to people, speak louder, for I am deaf." Now, these are pretty powerful words. But what's even more powerful is to realize that they came from Beethoven. Beethoven wrote the majority of his music when he was deaf. He wrote music where he actually had to lie down on the piano and feel the music. So being deaf and being hearing impaired requires that we have to not only communicate, but we have to internalize and we have to have executive functioning. That is, we have to accept that there are things that occur in our life and we have to move past it. Now, what becomes even more interesting is if we move past this and we start looking at technology. And this is, happens to be like probably my favorite story in all of cochlear implantation. The very first experiment occurred in the late 1800s. And it was done by a guy by the name of Volta. And you guys probably don't remember who he was, but Volta is the guy who invented the battery. That's why we have volts that come out of like the AC units and so forth. And I guess, I don't know, maybe they were totally bored in the 1870s, or maybe they had nothing to do. But seriously, in his journals, one day, Volta just woke up and he says, "Aha, I know what to do." So he takes this big, huge battery, walks up, and he puts the terminals of the batteries into his ears, and he turns it on and delivers 50 volts to his ears. That's half of what comes out of here. It's not surprising that he said, "I heard a boom." I bet he did. I think he heard a big boom. He says, "I heard gurgling." It's like blah, blah, blah. And then he writes, "I do not believe I will replicate this experiment." I mean, it's like it's totally perfect. You know, it's like, what more can you say? Because he's like saying it's like that thick boiling soup. I mean, you know that he had to fry his ears. But he then leaves and he goes to like a little villa in Italy. And this is, again, I'm not exaggerating. This is in his notes. And he starts talking to this woman about this experiment that he's not going to replicate. And this woman, interestingly enough, It's like, well, this guy's kind of weird, you know, having like Italian wine, whatever. But she then goes off to England, which is on record as having the worst winter ever in London. And here she is. So she's stuck in her little garret, and she's like, think about what this guy does. And so the next thing she does is she starts writing because she's stuck there, right? So what does she write? She writes Frankenstein. So we have the first experiment in cochlear implantation that basically leads to a whole history of arts and humanities and a whole way of actually looking at the world from a different perspective. Now, I can't tell you, but like 200 years go by, and it's until 1952 when all of a sudden the French get involved. And of course, now we're still talking wine. We've gone from the wine in Italy to, like, you know, probably the cider or whatever it was in London. And now we are talking about going worldwide. So in France, two physiologists introduce a person who is deaf. They put a wire through his ear. They put it all the way in the cochlea. Now stop about, I mean, really think about that, because you have to have had a lot of wine to let somebody do this. And all of a sudden, they start delivering electrical pulses to this person. And astonishingly, if the pulses come in fast, he hears a high pitch. If they come in slow, here's a low pitch. If they come in, here's something loud versus something soft. They write about this. It electrifies the entire world. All across the world, people go crazy because they now know the ear is so perfectly tuned that they can, like, begin to capitalize on it. So efforts go on in the United States, Australia, Europe, and all of the devices, no matter what we consider the device to be, are all the same. So we basically have a microphone. It collects the sound. The microphone, and it doesn't matter the size, the shape, the whatever, the microphone connects the sound. It takes it to a piece of hardware that's called a speech processor. The hardware can be very small, it can be whatever, but inside of this hardware is software. And the software is the fastest growing piece of cochlear implant technology today as we learn how to better code speech. That then goes up, they take the extraction from that, it goes up to an external receiver on the outside of the skull, and you'll see people wearing it here. It then goes across through a frequency modulated system to an internal receiver and then down to an electrode array, which can be designed in multiple ways to the cochlea. And I show this picture just because, one, it's part of the UT Dallas system, and I think it's a beautiful picture. But this will show you, here's your like tiny little cochlea. You can see it kind of being wrapped around. You can see the auditory nerve, which are the gold fibers going through. And you can see this electrode array that has various banded electrodes. Each of these are handmade. And what I can do, because the system is so organized, I can assign certain frequencies to each of these electrodes. And when I do that, I can make patterns of the stimulation, and your brain then interprets those patterns as speech. Now, what becomes really interesting when I do that is to think how far we've come. This literally is the first cochlear implant made by Cochlear Corporation. That little piece of hardware I call the speech processor, here it is. Right? here's the first electrode array. Now imagine what it must have been to be a pioneer back in those days where you had to come in and be deaf and come in and be hooked up to this. I can also show you in the United States what our first cochlear implant looked like for advanced bionics. Here it is. Here's the speech processor. And for you students, what I love about this is here you have an adult who actually has a sign here that says, tell us if you hear anything. And notice his finger is raised, I hear. Now imagine that we have taken that huge, huge, huge piece of equipment and miniaturized it to such a point that you can barely tell it's different than a hearing aid. And give us 10 more years, it'll be inside your middle ear. Now what's even more exciting is to look like this is what a kid looked like when I graduated from high school. Look at all this equipment. They had earbuds, they had FM systems, they were weighted down. I mean, the equipment was durable, it was rugged, it was crude. And if I take experiments and look at kids now, look at this. I mean, these are old devices, but the kids are wearing everything. It's all behind the ear. They can go anywhere. They can go swimming now and wear a cochlear implant. They can hear their parents in the water saying, that's dangerous, don't do that. It's a pretty important way to go. But what does sound like? Because I don't want you to think that this is a miracle where you and I can hear exactly the same way a person with a cochlear implant does. Because we're struggling, and the thing that takes up most of our time is trying to figure out, how do I best make this signal comprehensible? So the first thing we did was we said, okay, if I stretch out the cochlea, I know that it's tonotopic in nature. So that things that are here at the apical end are low frequency, and things that occur here at the base are high frequency. So what happens and what do you hear and how much information do you need? They did this during World War I and World War II as we went through the telephone, because you only get a certain band pass on your telephone because you don't need all the extra stuff, even though your ear can resolve it. So the first thing they did was they said, well, let's see what happens if I give you one low frequency and one high frequency. Not very good, is it? Well, let me increase it. Let me give you two and two. Still not very good, right? Let me give you a little bit more. I see some people nodding. Let me give you a little bit more. So, if I think about those sounds, it turns out that among us, when the sound is up really loud, that we only need 8 channels as normal adults to understand 100% of a sentence. But if you're 12, you need about 14 channels. And as my colleague, Andrea, please stand up. Yay. As my colleague Andrea Warner will show and is showing, if we take normal hearing babies and we present a signal to them who have a cochlear implant, they need almost 32 channels of information. So the amount of information that we are presenting to children has to change over time, be responsive and reflective, which means that we as professionals have to be extremely responsive. That is, we have to recognize that this is a developmental important issue. So let me show you why I believe communication is extraordinarily important. And I'm going to demonstrate to you through two large studies that we conducted through the National Institute of Health. The first was to take absolutely the first cohort of children who received cochlear implants, right? So data I'm going to be talking to you are children who had the first technology, who had the first requirements from the FDA. So they were not implanted before they were two, and they had no residual hearing. It's an extremely conservative group. We recruited them all throughout the Northern Hemisphere. And we published the first data looking at literacy and reading with this group. This is a group that is just now making it to teenage years, right? They've had enough years, so now we have the first set of children coming through that we can look at. And we have brought them back in between 15 and 17 years of age to look at how much progress they've made. So I want you to kind of capture this early study, because these were children that we tested between 8 and 9 years of age. I remind you, my first slide said that people who go through deaf education read at a second or third grade level. So we've now captured the children at the same age that they should be. These are children who all had an onset of deafness by age 3. By the time we tested them at 8 and 9 years of age, they had all had about 4 to 6 years of experience. So we're not talking about kids who are just having to learn to listen for the first moment. They were all implanted before age 5. And here become the open caveats for those of you who are scientists. They had no additional disabilities. They were monolingual, because at that time we had no other tests that we could measure performance on. And this is a key one, they had no open set speech perception. And for those of you who are students now, you know you're going to have up to about 30% open set because you have more residual fibers, et cetera. So understand, these are the deaf of the deaf of the deaf of the beginning. Okay? They've come from everywhere in the United States. They came back from everywhere in the United States. So let's look at speech perception. And I just want to clue you in, because I'm going to give you lots of slides that are the same way, where I'm trying to show you a lot of data. Right? Here are going to be my scores going along here. I've picked up percent correct at this moment. But everything you see coming along here is individual subject data. I'm trying to show you everything. So let me focus you first on the diamonds. The diamonds represent the speech perception scores of children between 8 and 9 years of age. And I have them ranked simply from the lowest to the highest scores. Okay? Now, if I look at that, the average score for those kids at 8, 9 for speech perception was about 47%. I mean, for a kid who's 90 dB or greater, fabulous score. But now what I do, if I focus your attention on these columns, I have overlaid the same data for the same children on top of this. So you can see I have some kids who still, at 15 and 17 years of age, made no progress. I have a number of children who made great progress. And for those of you who are clinicians, I'll point out these two who represent cochlear implant failures, of whom when we found, we referred and have been re-implanted and their performance has bounced. Okay? But within that time period, between 8 and 9 to adolescence, only 10% was gained in terms of speech perception. Let me move. If I look at quiet and noise, I can like see what they can do in quiet. Pretty good, 75%. In noise, not so good. if I look at what their intelligence is, and imagine I'm working with totally deaf people. So again, I'm showing you a standard score here. Standard scores are scores that allow you to represent performance relative to the normal population. Typically, the mean is 100, and you have a standard deviation of 15. So in the green, I've tried to show you what would be representative of a normal hearing, normal standard. What I'm also showing you by these little diamonds is the nonverbal performance IQ that we typically measure with people who are hearing impaired, because they don't have to have spoken language. And you can see as we look across that, that in point of fact, 87% of this population is in the normal range. Yahoo! But for the first time, we can also measure what their verbal performance is, and that's what you're seeing in these columns that are going across here. And when I look at the verbal intelligence, the ability to lose and use language there, I find 64% of this population can do that. So let's look at their language. If I look at their language, and again, I'm showing you again individual data because I want you to get a sense for this variance that we're talking about. I'm looking again at standard scores. In the green, I have put the normal limits. You can see that I have this huge range of individual performance in children on just a regular language measure. But let me make it more complex, because this is where it gets really interesting. I want to go to literacy, because we all know that literacy and being able to access the written word is where the digital world is taking us. So now let me look at standard scores on the Peabody Individual Achievement Test. I'm again showing you across here. If you focus on the diamonds, I'm showing you individual scores at age 8 and 9. And then I'm overlaying the reading scores in high school. If I was doing a really good job, those columns would be all above the triangles. And they are not. In fact, if I take and look at this data in a slightly different way, where now I'm showing you grade equivalent score, and I'm showing you when we initially tested them here versus when we tested them in high school, I want you to be struck by two big things. First, wow, how compact this group is. And, hip hip hooray, they're all like between the ages that they should be and better than the deaf population we had before. So we thought we were doing a great job. But then we ended up with this as they get to high school. Now it turns out that if you look at this very carefully and just pick a couple people in the middle of the road, I have some children just in the middle of the pack who did no change in reading. I have some children who made a moderate change, and I have some children who I believe made the change that you and I each make. They increased. And when I look at this population very critically, I have about 37% of the initial cohort of children who got cochlear implants who are reading at a level that is appropriate for their graduation grade. And I have about 17% who have made no progress. Now, if I think about this even further, I can look at their speech production, like how well do people understand them? Well, here's, again, one of these examples where you have percent correct. I'm showing you the data at age 8 in the diamonds of how well you would have understood these kids talking. And you can see, like, you understood them pretty well. And, like, they got even better when I looked at teenage years. But there are subtle problems with this group. Because if I take where they were all ranked from lowest to highest at high school, and I take those same speech samples that you all are listening to and say, oh, I understand this child, and I put them in a background noise, like what would you have to hear in a noisy classroom? What would you have to hear at McDonald's? How well would I understand if you were in a group of people who have to come up and ask me for help? Guess what? Their performance drops down hugely, on average by about 20%. Such that in noisy backgrounds, children that we thought we understood have complicating problems that we cannot understand yet. Now, it gets even more interesting because if I, like, sort of take a big design and I say, I've seen all of this variance, lowest to highest performance, what is contributing to them? Well, the first thing I can say is obviously the child brings in something. You know, he's got his IQ, blah, blah, blah. And the family brings in something. Well, if I take out the amount of contribution, it turns out in terms of speech production, speech perception, language scores, and reading scores, on four variables, I can explain the 22 to 13% of the variance. And that's a pretty large amount. It also says if I look at those, if I just look at gender, if I look at your nonverbal performance IQ, if I look at your family size, is it large or small, and how many resources do you have? You know, at least a fair amount of performance is pretty much accounted for. Now, if I go up and look at SES, you'll notice that I have a series of pluses here that go all the way across. And what that says is that every family has more resources, has more positive results for their children in terms of production, perception, literacy, and reading. Now, interestingly, go up one more for family size, and you see I have independent contributions that are negative. That says the smaller your family, the better your results are for production and perception. That is, if you have fewer children, you probably have more opportunities to talk to your mom and dad, and you probably get more interaction. Now, also notice, when I go up to the third one for performance IQ, that it doesn't matter how smart you are to know how good you talk or how good you listen. But how smart you are really influences how well you acquire language, and it really influences how well you read. Well, let's take it one more step, because of course I know deafness has to have some part of this. So does it make a difference of how long you were deaf? Shorter or longer? Does it matter if you rely on listening and speaking, or if you rely on sign? And over and beyond what I just showed you for the variance, I can account for, again, another 35 to 7% of the variance just on these two variables. Now, sign enhancement, as you notice, also has an independent contribution, as I've represented here by the negatives. That is, if you believe and your child has to rely on sign as a supplement to communicate, your production will be poor, your perception will be poor, your language will be poor, and your reading will be poor. And if I have to take a look at reading, the longer you are deaf, the poorer reader you are. Now let's take it another step further. Now let me bring it into executive functioning, which is where I'm going to end up with this talk. I'm going to measure it with just a simple variable that I'm calling verbal rehearsal speed. I'm measuring it by how long does it take you to remember something, how many digits can you remember in a forward span, a backward span, how many syllables can you say? I mean, I could go on and on and on. But if I just take that one simple, what can you plan, memorize, and repeat, look at this. This is astonishing. That figure is this explaining 13% more. Let me keep using the word more. I've already explained what's gone for the child and family. I've already looked at the deafness characteristics. And now I'm looking at verbal rehearsal speed. I can explain 13% more of the variance in these children's performance for production. How well can you say a sentence? I can explain 16% of what they're doing in terms of perceiving words. I get to language, whoa, 31%, and I get to reading, I'm looking at 23%. And if you notice, it independently is predicting scores as well. So I, at this moment, you saw those graphs, I can now account for 63% to 43%. But notice this one. Hold on, Margaret. The story gets better. So let's now ask, did their performance in elementary school at years 8 and 9 predict what their performance was like in high school? Well, if I take that into account and I start looking at the next set of information, I'm going to do the same story. So now I'm going to look at what their performance was in elementary school, and I'm going to look at what it was in high school. And I'm going to start off again with child and family figures, which we did. So we see the gender, we see performance IQ, we see family size, we see resources. Wow. In high school, these factors account for far less. But having resources and family size are independently contributing.
So you're saying these are contributing to change?
No, I'm only performance yet. I'll get to change. Okay. Yeah. Just where they are now. Okay? Now, let's look at duration of deafness. Over and beyond of the gender and the family and child, look at what I can account for now and look at these odd numbers here. And notice that sign enhancement is now, as opposed to where it went across and swept every dimension we measured in elementary school, it's really only contributing independently to how well you talk and how well you listen. So now, let me go back and look at my measure, kind of my independent measure of executive functioning. Wow. It's contributing very little to production. But boy, it's contributing almost the flip over when I get to reading and language. So now we get to Margaret's question of, does it matter where you were in elementary school? Does that give further predictive patterning, further predictive ability to look at where you are in high school? And the answer is yes, hugely, if you stop and think about it, particularly when we get to speech perception, when we get to language, and when we get to reading. Where you were at 8 and 9 years of age is a high predictor of where you're going to be at 15 and 17. It's huge. In fact, if I keep going with that, I can explain a huge amount of the variance in performance in teenagers who had the crudest technology that was introduced in the United States because it was the first, who had the worst hearing in the United States because we were conservative. I can predict their performance in high school fairly interestingly. So what do we make of all of this? Oops. Sorry. Well, let's just kind of use the stats. In this first cohort, 95% are mainstreamed. They're in normal hearing classrooms in high school. 72% are using the telephone, and by this concept, I'm talking listening and talking. 100% text. I mean, they're deaf. I mean, that's why we have, you know, caller ID. It was invented by the deaf. The majority will claim that they have both deaf and hearing friends. And out of this first cohort, most are expecting to go to college, even with reading levels that we know are substantially lower than they could be. If I take communication mode, those children who speak and listen, I can look at 93% having intelligible speech. I can see that 38% continue to use some form of sign language, mostly to talk with their friends, as I do. 10% are using assigned interpreter in the classroom. About 95% of the kids who started with really spoken language emphasis use very little sign in everyday conversation. They're mostly listening and talking. And 13% report that they have some sign because they all want to identify with the deaf community and it's their group. So they all have a little bit of sign. If I then look at those who have early sign use, you'll see that about 50% now out of that initial cohort are communicating using only spoken and listening. About 67% have speech that you, as a listener, would understand. 64%, however, almost double, are using assigned interpreter to help them in class to make sure that they are not missing subtle nuance. And about 11% have discontinued using sign language in high school. So when I bring up this whole concept of this verbal rehearsal and executive functioning, our next step forward of where we're moving and what we're looking at is we believe and are beginning to test now very systematically that, in essence, at least another 20 to 35% of the variance that's associated with performance in kids who are in teenage years is associated with what we call executive functioning actions. And that part of what happens is as these children, and there are lots of pieces we can go into, but like as these children are very, very young and they have to sprout all the neurons and then they have to prune them back in and begin to like fold in language and hearing and cognitive and motor things on top of that, that one of the things that is a problem for these kids is their ability to do executive functioning. And that means planning ahead. You know, when you're a kid in eighth and ninth grade and you have that really tight distribution, life is good because all of the adults in your life are planning it for you. You have a teacher who knows what the curriculum is. You have parents who are taking you here. I mean, everything is systematically organized. But unfortunately, when you start to move into the teenage and young adulthood, You have to take over that planning control and execute it yourself. And we suspect or hypothesize or pick another word, that this is going to be a very big difficulty for children who are getting these devices because no one thinks about it. Children who get cochlear implants are typically relieved of therapy in the school systems and typically relieved of therapy at home. But if we want to make them really uniformly great participants in our society, we have to teach them how to plan. That is, they need to know and take control of how do I start something and how do I end it. These children need to learn how to prioritize. These are advanced skills that no one thinks about. Because, you know, initially we all thought about, can they hear, can they speak, can they learn to read? You know, I mean, it's the lower level, low-hanging fruit stuff. But now what we need to do is to move these children to a higher level. And so we need to tell them how to stick to a task. I mean, they need to plan something, they need to prioritize it, they need to know how to begin it and how to end it. They need to also learn how to organize information because they do not organize information well. All of their language scores on pragmatics are low. And then finally, because of our technical world, they have to learn to multitask. And this set of children in this initial group do not do this well. And in part, it's because we never had to, as clinicians and parents, think about the fact that this was something we had to do. And so for every parent who is here, these are the things you need to be doing for your teenager. And for every clinician who's here, who has a teenager, these are the things we have to do to move them to a different plane. There are things we never thought about doing 5 years ago or 10 years ago. So if I think about that, what does that mean I have to do? Well, all of those tasks are related to the poorest things that we're measuring on these kids. That is, we need to teach them to have a working memory and recall. Where are you going? When are you coming back? Give them some accountability. There's all kinds of tasks that we can do, and I have them in the handout. We have to also recognize that we have to work on activation. Start something. Don't procrastinate. Start something. Have some type of arousal moment and extend effort. Children who are cochlear implant have a lot of difficulty with emotional control. So we need to like help them get that. We need to work on the language internalization. And the biggest one, which I always think I should probably have flashing, is they have to learn to problem solve. And that means that you have to take information from a situation you know, deconstruct it, and learn how to apply it to something new. Now, these are huge because this is what young teenagers need to know as they move into adulthood. And yet, we never thought we had to know because we were too prioritized on earlier and different things. So, the way as a parent you can help your child is teach them to initiate a new project. Sit down and figure out something they can do. Maybe they take out the trash every day. Maybe they help another person in the neighborhood. Teach them to inhibit external kinds of things so that they concentrate on the major topic. You want them to concentrate. You want them to be able to shift. Like, okay, at 4 o'clock you do this, and at 6 o'clock you do this. You want to teach them how to shift their attention from one task to another in the plan. And you've got to have them learn to plan. Maybe they write it out. Maybe they set up something. But you've got to teach them to do that planning. And you've got to put them under a situation where they have to learn to organize information and use that organization in order to move from step one to step two. And they're not going to be able to learn this easily. So it's going to be the parents primarily at home that are going to be doing this, because by the time we get to teenage years, therapy in the school system is zilch. Then you have to teach your child to self-monitor. Let them learn to make a chart. Did I get this done? Did I not? You are the one who continually reinforces and shows, have I monitored that? Am I moving there? And then you have to recognize that we're talking about teenagers. Teenagers get frustrated and they hate not doing well. So this is also a time period where you have to be the most loving parent to the most disgusting person you know. Right? I mean, it's just life, you know? You're just going to have to love them forever. And so this part, the reinforcement and the small steps to say you're going forward, are extraordinarily important. So in conclusion, I'm going to tell you rehab works. I can tell you that on measures of production, perception, literacy, and reading, we can do it. I can tell you that we're now good when they're in elementary school, they're good in high school. And then I can caution my optimism by saying, by the time we get to high school, we also have to look at these measures that we're using related to how well do they plan, how well do they do. So if you have a real emphasis with a cochlear implant child that's got spoken and listening, you'll do fine. And I'm going to conclude there and take any questions you might have. Yes, ma'am.
I have a son who's 16, and a pretty decent reader. Mm-hmm. He's been wearing hearing aids for 18 months, and he was implanted probably about 8 years ago. He's bilateral now. He has a terrible time of inferring information and reading. He's been homeschooled his whole life, so from the time he was very little, I would ask him questions. You know, do you understand what just happened? Why did they do that? So this is something I've been doing with him all of his life. And now that he's starting to take SATs, I see this kid does not understand tone, the kinds of things that are
the nuance. The nuance, exactly.
In the SAT, they're wanting to know, do you understand the tone that this person, you know, all of these different questions where inferring is coming in very, very seriously, and he doesn't get that at all.
Right. So in an instance like that, what you need to do is introduce a lot of new situations. And if you're doing the homeschooling, which I think you are, what you should do is say, okay, as an example lesson plan, I'd be happy to correspond with you, but as a typical lesson plan is say, okay, I want you to go to this new situation and use your language in this way. So let's say you're going go to the mall. And you say, I need you to find a size 16 shoe. It's an unusual size. It's hard to do. Go out. And give him practice on doing something that's close set, because you know what the shoe size is. Mm-hmm. And then start opening up more and more to the nuance. The nuance is going to be hard. How much is he reading in the evening? Can
he
you tell?
He loves to read. He's actually a pretty good reader. But, I don't know how much depth he's getting in really comprehending all,
No, exactly.
It sounds like this is common.
It is common. And this is one of the things that we're noticing, which we would not have noticed 20 years ago. So, exactly. So, I would introduce him to new situations, ask him to apply knowledge to different ways. Perhaps having work as a volunteer for some groups where he has to go off and actually converse with someone within a limited set. So, because you don't want to discomfort, you want to just expose and let the problem solving sort of take its own. But you're going to have to push, because when they're, it looks to us as if when people are in this limited context, the natural response for parents and clinicians is to limit their context even further. And what you want to do is push the envelope. You want to push it and you want to reinforce it. Push and reinforce. Don't make your steps too big. And you know your son well enough. Don't make them too big, but push and then reinforce.
Make sure you hand in your feedback form on your way out, either up here or in that desk that's right out in the auditorium. Second, our next talk is February 14th, so feel free to come back and report if you need me there. And then third, if you have any other questions for our speaker that you'd like to talk to one-on-one, please feel free to come on down here after that. All right, thank you very much, and have a good rest of the day.